give every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Time. you, Jesus. Lord, you're so good to us. Lord, and we want to know you, God. We want to know you more. God, we have tasted and seen that you are good. Lord, we have tasted and seen that you are good. And we long for more of you, Lord. Help us to see, God, more clearly, God, who you are and how much you care about us, Lord. You are so good to us, God. Give you our hearts. Give you our minds, God. We love you, Lord.
Thank you. God.
You are trustworthy with everything. And to see, God, how kind you've been, in, Lord, in giving us Jesus, Lord, and you, God, coming and dying for us, Jesus, in the midst of our wickedness, knowing full well our hearts, God, you still came and died for us. Let us see your goodness, God, and trust you more. Let us see these things. God, help us to take the time and the energy and the effort to recount how good you've been to us. Lord, to count you worthy, Lord, to do that. I know, God, when we do that, we see how wonderful you are, Lord, and our trust for you grows, Lord. God, we pray that you would bless this service today. We pray, God, for your voice, for your words, Lord. For with your word, there is power, God, in changing our lives and our hearts, God. We need it. We pray for it now. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 You guys can go ahead and greet each other this morning.
Chapel Three Crosses. It's truly a blessing to have every one of you here with us this morning. If this is your first time joining us, a warm welcome to you. If you haven't already received a welcome packet, please don't hesitate to reach out to one of our greeters after the service. As we move forward with our service today, we have a couple of important announcements to share, so let's dive right in. Are you passionate about youth ministry? We're searching for committed volunteers to join hands with our youth leaders in shaping the next generation. If you're eager to make a difference, please connect with Elijah Estrada after the service for further details. Are you musically inclined? We're seeking volunteers to join our worship team. We'd love to hear from you if you play bass, guitar, piano, or drums. Reach out to Michael or Lindy Matthews for more details. This summer, we have many conferences for all age groups. Let's take a look at the conferences happening this spring and summer. Join us for this year's 2024 Moving Forward Conference. It's happening in Ruidoso, New Mexico from July 18th to July 20th. With the theme Moving Forward in Storms, it's set to be an enriching experience. Don't miss this chance to connect with churches from across the state and beyond. Save the dates now. Child care services will be available during the conference. Save the date, May 30th to June 1st. Get ready for 3 days of unmatched excitement, spiritual growth, and fun in Ruidoso, New Mexico. YouthCon 24, Rise Up, is just around the corner, and you won't want to miss out on this life-changing experience. This conference is open to 6th and 12th graders. If you have any questions about signing up, reach out to Elijah Estrada. Join us for the Thrive Servant Conference at Calvary Chapel New Harvest. This event is focused on deepening our understanding of serving in the church and embracing God's wisdom and leadership. Mark your calendars, Friday, April 26th and Saturday, April 27th. For more info, visit calvarynhll.com. That does it for all of our announcements this week. Thank you for being a part of our church family. Stay connected, stay engaged, and continue to grow in the Word. At this time, please silence your cell phone and prepare your heart for the Word of God.
Can you hear me? It's hard enough to see me back here. I was like, wait till the lights come on. Someone's talking back here. Well, that is great. A lot of things going on this summer. Continue after Resurrection Sunday. Continue to pray for those that came, those that don't know the Lord, that they, you know, as the seed has been planted, that as God will speak to their hearts, as we know He will, but they will be open to the message. I wanted to speak about a couple things really quick, if I can remember where it's at. That's not it. Okay. So I wanted to bring up the Thrive Conference. It's coming up here pretty soon. So I invite you guys to go to that. I want to show you what's involved. You see the time frame. It's a transformative event. It's geared towards servants to help you if you're thinking about serving or need maybe just some encouragement, profound wisdom. As in this, they're going to have different breakout sessions as well. They're going to be workshops, as you're going to see here. Here's a list of some of the workshops. They're actually going to be about 11. And the thing that I like about what they're doing different this year, they're going to give you three opportunities. So you can actually go to three different ones or the same one a couple of times if you need to get more information from that. So I encourage you to put the dates on your calendar, plan to go up there. Again, it's a should be a Friday, I believe it's a Friday and Saturday. I looked at the dates and forgot the actual day. But Friday evening at 5 o'clock is registration, and they're actually going to feed us. And it's a free event. I got to put that out. It's a free event. So free food is the way I put it together in my head. So I'm going to be there. So I encourage you guys to go if you can as well. And if you know, it says communion, and today would have been a perfect day for communion, but we're not going to do it today. But it'll give you time to think about, because next week is when we normally do communion. So we're going to do part two of communion. As I told you last time, as I was going through it, that's been a couple weeks ago, that there was so much in it, I'm going to do part two. And so when we're done with part two, I hope that it will help us as we prepare for communion next week. So you'll be able to reflect on the study till next Sunday, preparing your hearts and minds and to enter in it into a way that pleases God. Not only pleases God, that benefits you as well, because He designed it, as you're going to see, to remind us, to encourage us, to guide us, to direct us, to also to bring unity. I don't know if you guys realize that communion is about unity with Christ, but also unity within the body of Christ. So with that all said, let's begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we again thank You this morning for this time of worship, just praising You, Father. And I ask You to go before us as You've given me this message this morning, as we continue verse by verse this 1 Corinthians, this amazing letter that You inspired Paul to write. You give him the words to speak to our hearts, Lord. Words that will change and mold us to be like Your Son, Lord. We thank You, and again, we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we look at communion, do this in remembrance of me. We hear that over and over. So what is communion? It's a practice of communion is one of two ordinances, speaking of communion and baptism. Now, understand this. I think you all know this, that the communion isn't given a certain how many times you must do it. It says, do this in remembrance of me. It doesn't tell you that you have to do it every Sunday, every day. It says just do it to observe and be reminded. Because communion is a reflection. It's a reflection of many things. It gives us an opportunity, I should say opportunity helps us to reflect not only on our individual sins and remind us that we need to seek after forgiveness before we go into communion. It's going to remind us you need to repent of your sins before you go into communion, because basically it's going to give you opportunity to deal with it before you go into communion. Because if you go into communion with unforgiven sins, God will discipline you, as you're going to see. It's not a scare method, but I think God knows our hearts. He knows our tendency to push sin aside or push it deep down. Have you done that yourself? Push sin where, like, if I don't see it, it's not there, but yet you can experience it in your own life. But it's not only about sin and forgiveness. It's about reflecting on what else. What else does communion speak to us about? When you think about communion, it reminds us of God's grace. It reminds us of God's love that Christ exhibited for us. He didn't say, just say, I love you. Now, it's easy to say, I love you, isn't it? I'm sure we all have said it, not necessarily meaning it. But when you see it illustrated, and we see this, the actions Christ did for us as he died on the cross. Not only was he willing to go to the cross, he's willing to die on it. So as Christians, as we come together, we demonstrate this union with each other and with Christ. There's a beautiful picture of our unity with Jesus, but also the unity that we have in the body here. And communion is also a commonality of us sharing in the Spirit. As we all have the Holy Spirit, he lives in us. We come together and sharing that experience together. And this is actually what Jesus wanted for us in his prayer in Philippians chapter 2. And John talks about this in John 17. He says, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may be perfectly united. So communion is a perfect picture of what it will be like soon. When Jesus returns, changes us to be like him, and then that unity will be perfect. But now we can experience, in a sense, taste a little bit of what it's going to be like to be unified as a body, as a family under Christ. Now, as we continue to go to the 1 Corinthians, one thing we notice and we should all be reminded of is it didn't take long for this observance to become abused and distorted, did it? Think about this. When did Paul write this letter? First of all, when did Jesus die? Guesstimate, 33 AD. And this letter was written by Paul around 53 to 54 AD. Say, give or take 20 years, and this observance was being abused. And when you see really abused, they were actually coupling their communion. I don't think there's a problem with that in their society, in their culture. They would eat the agape meal at the same time, which was a good time to fellowshipping together. We love to eat together, right? Isn't it a great time of just hanging out? I mean, the food's awesome, but the fellowship as well. But they took it so far as to make it all about the food, all about the drinking, and not even really about Jesus Christ. And I think one of the biggest problems, there's several problems that the Church of Corinth had. The reason why they're in such a bad place of abusing this remembrance, this communion, because they were taking advantage of abusing the freedom in Christ. We all have freedom in Christ. But I think the biggest thing that I see, and remember where Corinth is such a corrupt city, they were bringing the world into the church. They were bringing the world thinking, the world attitude within the church. Do we not see that today? We see that same thing happening. And I think as we get closer to the return of Christ, we're going to see more and more of that. The church itself is looking more like the world. You ever wonder, how can there be a one world religion with Christianity? I thought, there's no way. Well, once you remove the Bible, which has already happened to many churches, it's basically removing God. Now it's more about entertaining and just making you feel good for the moment. I don't know about you, but I don't want to come here and feel good. I mean, feeling good is great, right? But if you go out the door and that's the end of it, what good is it? It only serves temporary. It's basically a picture of the world. Everything the world gives you is temporary. We want things that last for eternity. Experiencing God every day, experiencing more of Christ and us changing. As we come in here every week and as you go out, and you go at home and study, being equipped to proclaim. You guys are being equipped today to proclaim the good news to this is where God has you. And we always talk about, well, I'm at home. Well, you got some kids that the world are just waiting to get a hold of to influence. You can influence them for the Lord. Work, And not to belittle that, that is quite a job. Any husband that says, you guys don't do anything, stay home for a couple of days. Actually, we don't need about a couple hours. I know we have the school. I love the school, but I stick my head in the classroom for about 30 seconds, and I'm tired already, and then I come back out. But God may, where you have it, work, school, whatever God has you, he's placed you there, and he's equipping you or has already equipped you to proclaim the gospel. So that's why I believe there's a need for a deep dive into communion, into this chapter, chapter 11 of 1 Corinthians. And within the communion, there are many purposes, not just one purpose, but many. And so a clear understanding of a communion, I believe, will be a blessing to you and me, but also encouragement as we need encouragement. So let's begin. We're going to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 17 to 22. He says, in the following directives, I have no praise for you. Remember, we went over this not long ago, just repeating that sentence. In the following directives, I have no praise for you. Could you imagine a letter be written to you? Okay, I'm writing to you, but I have no praise for you. It's like, well, I think I'm done with this letter. He goes on to say, for your meetings do more harm than good. Now, he's talking about communion. Communion is supposed to be a blessing, but he's saying your meetings do more harm than good. In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you, and to some extent, I believe it. It's about unity, remember I was telling you? No doubt there have to be differences among you to show which of you have God's approval. When you come together, is it not the Lord's Supper you eat? It's kind of like it's asking a question. Is it not the Lord's Supper? It's not about you and eating, it's about the Lord. For as you eat, each of you goes ahead without waiting for anyone else. It says, one remains hungry, another gets drunk. What a picture. Think about that communion. If we were to have, let's say, a big meal before communion, and all that happened before we actually came in and partook of the elements. He says, don't you have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you for this? Certainly not. So as we look back at the Corinthians' time of communion, their services had become corrupted. And here's what they became corrupted with: selfishness, drunkenness, discrimination against the poor. And those who were participating in the church of this communion were not honoring God. Not only were they not honoring God, they were not edifying their fellow believers in this celebration. It's a time of celebration. But there was many that weren't celebrating because they lacked, while others had too much. Now, in the early days of the church, the Christians celebrated the Lord's Supper with feasts. We saw that in Acts chapter 2. But what is even worse than what they're doing, I would say not even worse, but combined to what they're doing, what was seen? The Corinthians were publicly overindulging in church services and discriminating against the poor. What does that mean? That means the people, unbelievers, were outside. It was such a spectacle. They were watching. Did that bring glory to God? Look at some churches today. Some things they're doing dishonors God. It's a show. It's about all these things. Matter of fact, it's getting worse. It's bringing the things of the world in that the Word of God speaks directly against. Their action, Paul said, were equivalent to, he said, despising the church of God. He said that in verse 22. When I hear about and I'm looking at what you're doing, you're basically despising the church that God created to worship and glorify him, to represent him. You realize that as Christians, we're called to represent God, ambassadors to this lost world. So after that, Paul then goes on. He says, okay, here's how you're supposed to observe it properly. And he stresses the central focus of this celebration is to remember Christ's suffering and proclaim his work of salvation. It's not about the food. And really, it's not about you. It's about him and what he did for us. What a message the world needs to hear. But the message you're proclaiming is a worldly picture. And that's how the church is weak and ineffective, because the world looks at it and says, you're as bad as us or worse. Can you imagine? The world says, you're worse than we are. That's a horrible thing to think, but we're seeing that today. Again, remember, this started at the very beginning of the church. This was already happening because of the sinful nature of man. As we're been changed. We're still a work in progress, aren't we? We need to not allow the worldly way of thinking to continue to affect us. And that means we can become Christians, but we need to mature and grow. Because if we don't grow as a Christian, we're going to do things like the world. Just like remaining an infant. Can you imagine being 16 years old and doing things like an infant? Well, the world's kind of getting that way, isn't it? It's training our kids to be like that. Let's go on. Let's look at verses 23 to 26. He says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you." Again, this was given to Paul by Jesus Christ himself. He says, "The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took this cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Now, these verses are probably well known to most people. Outside of 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the love chapter, everyone knows that. It's all about love, which it is. But this is just as well known. And sometimes even when I read it, I think if something's common to us, we kind of gloss over it, don't we? We miss the deepness, the depths of what God is telling us or what Jesus said. It forms the center of communion in churches. What churches observe today, these verses is basically what we see communion surrounding. It's kind of a condensed version of what happened with Jesus as he set forth the first communion supper, as he sat with his disciples, right before he was going to die for us. It's amazing how Paul's able to condense all this in such a short, less than 100 words. These verses, this paragraph shows us how we're to actually celebrate the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper is a celebration. And as we're going to see, it's not about then, now, and what's coming in the future. But I like the way Andrew Wilson described communion. Let me see if I have this here. He said this. He says, when speaking of communion, he says, "We look up in gratitude to God." Beginning at the very beginning of verse 23, he speaks about thanksgiving to God. "Giving thanks," he broke and said. Giving thanks to God for the gift of that he's given us of the bread and wine, which represent what? The blood and the body of Christ. We begin with thanksgiving. And then he says we look back. We look back to what? In remembrance of Jesus. We look back to how his body was broken. How it was broken for you and how it was broken for me. And who himself established this covenant, reminding us to reflect on this. And I think sometimes he says, I need to remind you of this. Why? Because we forget, don't we? And then he also says, we look forward. Prophetically, we look forward. Communion also reminds us of this. We look forward to the day of this prophecy of the Lord's return. Now, the Word of God did prophesy that Jesus would come the first time, didn't he? He did come. Many people say it's not true, but it's in the Bible, it's in historical writings, they're not the Bible, outside sources. I don't even know how you use the right word there, but sources that are not the Bible, historical sources. Josephus is one. There's several other that record that Jesus walked the earth for 40 days. Now, we're very far past that, and people can say, oh, no, it never really happened. But you guys know, you repeat a lie over and over enough, people begin to believe it. And that's what they began from the very start when Jesus was resurrected. They said, oh, someone, they moved his body. They stole his body. And matter of fact, they had to pay them money to say this. Now, if they had to pay them to say it, what does that tell you? It wasn't true. And in the next section, we're going to read verses 27, 28. We'll also see this. Wilson says, we also look within. As we're all talking about communion, he says, we look within and we look around. What does he mean? He says, at the rest of the body, we look around at the rest of the body. And we see that in communion, it reminds us that we're united. We have this unity together. And he says, we also look within. We look at the rest of the body. We look within ourselves. to see where we are. Again, so we look around at each other, right? We see that unity. We see the, and then we look within, we see the unity with Christ, but we also look within ourselves to see where we are as Christians, as believers. And so now that we understand this foundation and the purpose of communion is not what the Church of Corinth was doing, we're able to go forward and look at communion in a little more in depth. And Paul says, therefore. So as verse 27, he says, therefore. What is he saying? All that I just established, this foundation, this understanding, here's how you apply it. He says, therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. Don't you like that? Fallen asleep. Many of you have died because of your unrepented sins. So Paul now teaches the Corinthians how should you avoid taking communion unworthily. He's not saying not to take it, but how to not go into it in the wrong manner, wrong attitude. He says it begins by, you know, before we go into communion, what we do, we give you time of self-examination, self-contemplation, in a sense, looking. And I used to say, examine your hearts. Well, that doesn't work too well, does it? Because who shoved all that stuff way down? You did. Ask the Holy Spirit to examine your hearts deep within you. Bring these things up so you can repent of this. Lord, forgive me. You know what? And that's good. That's another thing about communion. It brings these things up so you can deal with them and stop carrying them around. And it says God is faithful to forgive us. If God is faithful, why do we carry him along as we listen to the flesh? Because being in sin is not comfortable, is it? It's not comfortable approaching a forgiving God, but as we get close to him, that light shines on our wickedness and we feel unworthy. We feel dirty. But he says, come to me, and as he forgives us, we're basically washed and cleaned. But as Christians, we're talking about Christians carrying sin around that weighs you down. So you see a great purpose of communion? Examine. Self-examining their motives. Not only your motives, but your actions. We're talking about actions. How about motives? Why do we do things? Do we do things so the world can see us, or do it for the glory of God? Hey, did you see what I just did? I did that for the Lord. I did that. Let me show you. If you didn't see it, let me show you. I actually had someone, everyone's video recording everything, right? You know, at my age, in our generation, we can look back and we thank the Lord that we have few pictures. Bell bottoms and what was that one? You have short hair on the top and hair and long in the back. See, you guys probably had one of those mullets. I don't even know what it was because I didn't have one. I don't have a picture to prove it. Anyway, imagine now they have pictures of everything. How foolish are they going to look at 30 years old if we're still here and they're like, oh, look, Mom, this is what you ate. Who cares? We're going to take a picture of that too. Bell bottoms. It's amazing how all that stuff came back in. You should have just hung on to those bell bottoms. You know what I really like is work pants. I get ripped in them, I throw them away. Man, they're worth a lot of money. They even got worse. Did you see them? Not to judge younger people, but from your knees up to your thighs, it's like, it's cool. It's called, when we used to go to school like this, it's like, oh, you need some help? So they were called to, Paul's writing this letter, so you need to self-examine yourself. Prepare yourself. Don't flippantly, like next Sunday as we come to communion, just don't approach it without any thought and any examination about eating and drinking. I'm just going to go through it. Sometimes we go through the motions. We need to do it in the correct way to avoid God's discipline upon ourselves. So the phrase that Paul wrote, he says, in an unworthy manner. Now it could refer to in general, as remember he's writing to the Corinthians. It could mean harboring unconfessed sin while participating in the Lord's Supper. Confession of sin is what we need to do before we enter into this communion. So we need to prepare our hearts. Basically, it's a form of worship. As we come into worship, Lord, these things I'm dealing with, before I go into this worship, forgive me. Bring these up so I can repent. But more specifically, as he's writing this letter to the Corinthians, he had something else in mind. As he looked at the church of Corinth, he saw a lack of love and unity within that body. They enter into, again, as I described their communion, drunkenness and overeating, and others weren't getting food. Isn't that incredible? Someone gorging and while others had nothing. So he's specifically thinking of that. But it does apply to sins in our own lives. And in a different way, in the context of where in that time specifically that he was talking to that, but for us, it could be that way. In some churches, they could enter it in that way. But more likely is the way we enter in it with sin in our hearts. Not only that, he speaks of selfish division. Can we not relate to that? Maybe here in some of us, before we entered the communion, we have created or creating division among other believers or within the church. It only takes one person to cause division, because division apparently likes company, and they go get others and divide. And I said this and the pastor didn't this. Or hopefully not me, leave me out of it, but usually I'm in it, right? This or that, or I don't like this. And usually it's about nothing. In this case, it's about food. We're more than food, physical things. We're about the spiritual things. So there were selfishness, there were division. The guilty of great offense. So this is one thing that Paul really has in mind as he's looking at the church of Corinth, the division. The dishonoring of how they displayed themselves among each other, but before the world. It dishonored God. He says, you're doing more harm than good for yourselves and for the world that's looking at you. Remember, as Christians, we don't particularly like that. And you ever have someone that's not a believer and say, oh, I thought you were a Christian, because you do something they say, somehow they know. It's like, well, how would you know you're not even a Christian? I know I had a couple issues as I was going through school to become an electrician. And again, I'll confess this, the first one, because my wife will be here the second. She came up to me as I installed this light switch. She says, you don't do it that way. I'm like, who's going to school for this, you or me? You know, sometimes I think that way as a Christian, when an unbeliever says, you call yourself a Christian? I'm like, yeah, but not a perfect one. So we always got to think, okay, if that's really pointed out, is there some truth in it? And a lot of times they're using it to get you to basically just shut up, to stop talking about Jesus. Don't stop talking about Jesus. Just say, hey, you know, you're right. I'm not perfect. Forgive me. I shouldn't have done that. But it's an opportunity to show humility, which the world doesn't like to show, do they? So Paul was warning the Corinthians. Christian, he says, you need to treat the Lord's Supper with reverence and to practice it in a spirit of self-examination. They were doing none of it. They were just, it looked like a pagan religion. Isn't that what they were most used to? Having this big old party, and it would, a lot of horrible things were going on during these pagan, not just food in excess. However, this was not written as he's writing to them. He's not, even to us, to exclude us from the table. He's not saying, okay, you need not come to the communion table. Many people, they won't come because of where they're at, what they're sinning in. Many, based on this passage, will not partake of communion. If they're struggling with a certain sin or wrestling with a particular temptation. But this would be like, okay, say, don't go in communion because of this. It's just be equivalent to saying, a doctor saying to a sick person, get well and then come see me. Or a loan officer saying to a poor person, you need a loan. Yeah, that's why I'm here. Get some money, I can help you. So what I'm saying, communion table, is as you come to it, you come right before you enter into actually partaking of it, you have that time of examination. So you see the full picture is, okay, if you have these sins, perfect opportunity to repent before the Lord. If you've ignored them, if you put them aside, and I think we all do this, we can think of someone else. Well, I'm sure they're holding. No, how about yourself? We all hold on to sins. And the Lord says, this is to remind you of what you need to do. Remember why I died? I died for your sins. So give me your sins. This is a perfect place for it. Maybe when we come to it, we say, Lord, I desperately need you in my life. Even as a believer, I need you in my life. I've allowed these sins to separate. Even as a Christian, sin separates us from the Lord. In a sense, we don't have that closeness that we need. When you're in sin as a Christian, you say, where's God? He feels like he's moved away. God doesn't move. See, just think of God as this huge stone. And you look at it and say, well, earlier the stone was like 10 feet away. Now it's 30. What happened? You moved. Stone's not the greatest picture, but what we see is because God is righteousness, his light shines on his wickedness. So the closer we get to it, it shines on that need. So we need that. We need to draw close to him. That's what communion does. We get really close and we see that sin, and what do? We run away. That's one choice. Or the second is, Lord, forgive me, and he forgives you. It's kind of painful, isn't it? But what's more painful, repenting or carrying it around with you forever and ever? We eat of the communion, we take of it, knowing that we're forgiven. We say, thank you, Lord. I celebrate. It's a celebration of what you did for me. Again, Paul is saying, examine yourself, repent of your sins, so that we are honoring God with our lives. If we don't, as we see the Corinthians doing, many of our lives as believers are mocking of what Jesus did for us. If we remain in sin, we're mocking what Jesus did. He came to cleanse us of all our sins. Is Jesus not enough? And I don't really think all of us look at it like that. I think more of us, it's just sometimes the unworthiness of being a believer and in sin. We're all been there, right? Or can be there. Because we're not perfect yet. That's why we look forward to so many reasons. Jesus is returning soon. And I just heard on the radio yesterday, this is kind of scary and exciting at the same time. He says, everyone around Israel is coming against them. I'm like, man, that sounds prophetic. It's like, maybe it's going to be tomorrow. I almost didn't finish my study. It's like, maybe he's coming here any moment. But it is very soon, isn't it? So to walk through these real quickly, let me see if I actually threw them up here for you. Yes. How can we take part of communion in a worthy manner, thus avoiding God's discipline? The first one is examine ourselves. I think that's important we begin there, right? Because I don't know about you, but I can examine a lot of other people. I can look around and say, wow, they're messed up. When I say that, I just realize I don't have to look at myself. It's kind of like when they say, when you're pointing at someone else, they said there's three fingers pointing at you. So you kind of hold your hand over like this. You always do it like this, right? It's like, oh, examine ourselves. This means we need to plead with the Lord as David did in Psalm 139, verse 23 to 24. He says, search me. Search me, God, and know my heart. See, that goes with what I just said, asking him to search your heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting. Lord, examine my heart. If there's anything there, lead me in the right direction. Lead me in the way that brings glory to you. And then the second is judge the body rightly, which is the body of Christ. So we look at communion. It's a thing we do together. We need to be respectful and treat everyone in a dignified manner. Not looking at their status, not looking down on them in where they're at spiritually. So you say, well, I don't look at people in their status. Well, okay, maybe you don't look at their financial status, but maybe in their spiritual maturity status. Like, oh, you know, that's just a baby Christian. They don't know what the heck they're talking about. Some way. But as a mature Christian, well, you can't be much more mature if you're saying that, right? You're a mature Christian. You come along and say, I understand. I've been there. I need to help them grow. Come alongside them. So we need to check ourselves and see if we're respecting and loving other believers within the church. Is it not easy to not love those in the church? Because, again, some of us got some quirky personalities. And I'll admit, if I listen to myself, I can't listen to my recordings sometimes. I'm like, man, you say some dumb things up there. But that's my quirkiness. But we got to understand we're not perfect. And God has put us together. Sometimes the difference is to, as it says, iron sharpens iron. It's like, Lord, why did you give me this person? Because you needed it and they needed it. So let him shape you. Maybe he'll, as you both change, you'll be easier to get along with or everyone else. And number three, wait for one another. Can you just picture them? And I don't know if you guys have ever seen it here, but I don't think so. As we have the food that someone just pushes out of the way and they're coming to the front of the line. It's like, I'm starving to death. Matter of fact, they normally don't see anything. Just like, get out of the way. We must look out for the interests of others. We think about food, but how about in other things? Most of the time we're thinking about ourselves, aren't we? That's the flesh. It's all about me. There are needs in the body. And I think that comes from getting to know each other. That's why it's important we know each other. How are we going to trust in each other if we don't know each other? I'm not going to go to a stranger except maybe a stranger I think, oh, I'll never see this one again. But someone that you don't know well, but you see, I'm not going to tell them my personal stuff. So that's kind of like in the church. Someone you see at church all the time, but you don't know, you're going to say, walk up to them, hey, I'm struggling with this. Can you pray with me? You're not. I think we need to get together with some people we don't know or have that, and let's begin to hang out with them. Now, again, we all don't click the same way. Weirdos click with weirdos. I click with Marco really well. It's weird how, yeah, we're not too great. We've done some crazy things together. We did that thing to Pastor David, and he'd been harassing me for 14 years, and we put this video up at a conference of him and a cowboy thing. He does not like the cowboy fan. He's not a cowboy fan, but he's always bashing the Cowboys. And all I had to say is, Marco, I got an idea. And I said one sentence, is, I got you. And so like minds think alike, it's good and bad. You're not going to get these verses up there because for some reason they're not there. If you're not there, turn your Bibles there. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, we're going to look at verses 31 to 32. And listen to how this is. But if we judge ourselves, we would not come under judgment. When we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned in the world. So what is Paul saying in these two verses? Irreverent conduct of the Lord's Supper invites God's correction. Enter into communion before you examine yourself. You're asking for the Lord to discipline you. He says this. So he says, it would be better for you to deal with that before you go into communion. We got a whole week to get ready, right? Next week we're going to have communion. So that we enter in it and he doesn't judge us. Or I should say judge us, but what really we look at is him disciplining his children. So we don't feel the hand of God's correction. Now, what does God's discipline look like? We don't need to wonder what it looks like. Paul tells us here back verse 30, he says, this is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. Judgment is significant, this discipline. Evidently, many Corinthian Christians had experienced illness, and some had even died because of God's discipline. That sounds kind of harsh, doesn't it? He warns us. In writing, eating and drinking judgment, Paul's not referring to eternal judgment, but to corrective judgment. So here's the picture. The judgment that you get is not the judgment of a condemning criminal. It is a father correcting disobedient children. I suppose it'd be like to your kids, okay, tell me what you did. It's going to be different consequences. If you tell me, if you confess it, I'll be a little more lenient. But if you don't, you know what's coming. Kind of like that, isn't it? God gives us opportunity. But David Guzik, he actually expounds on this repentant of sin of a believer and how it can actually lead to death. Can you imagine unrepentant sin leading to death? That doesn't even seem right, does it? Or maybe we don't completely understand it. David Guzik said back in 1 John, if you want to write this down, 1 John chapter 5, verse 16, there's a sin leading to death. If we remember Ananias and Sapphira, you remember that one? It seems so, it was spoken of in Acts 5, it seems so little. They sold their house. It was an amazing thing. You know, it would have been so simple. They said, we sold our house for this much and we kept this much. There would have been no problem. But they said, we sold it and we give it all to the Lord. So apparently a believer can sin to the point where God believes, you know, it's just best to bring you home. Probably because at some point you've compromised your testimony so bad that it's better that you come home than continue to dishonor God. I think about that. I don't know how God makes his decision because his wisdom is thinking is above mine. Because I'm thinking, Lord, there's some that I thought would have probably taken them home a long time ago. And then I think, well, maybe they're not even Christian. So maybe that's the reason, right? Everyone that claims to be a Christian that's proclaiming the word is not always Christians, are they? I believe the disciples one time said, these guys are speaking in your name, but they don't know you. And he's like, let them continue. When they get to before God and they can say, look, we did all these miracles. And what is God going to say? I never knew you. Doesn't mean he can't use you, but he never knew you. Now let's look at verses 33 to 34. So then, my brothers, after I've told you all this direction, when you come together to eat, wait for each other. When we come to eat together, wait for each other. Now again, speaking of the agape, as you come to eat, wait upon the other. Don't be the... Now, again, someone's got to get in the line first. You're going to feel guilty when we have a potluck here. It's like, well, I don't want to be the first one. You know, that's not what he means. We're talking about, you know, at the pushing someone back. If anyone is hungry, he should eat at home. So now, agape, now he's looking at communion. He says, communion itself is not about eating. If you're hungry, before we come to communion, don't think that little cracker is going to help you. Eat before you come. So that it may not result in judgment. And when I come, I will give you further directions. So Paul summarizes the way we should conduct ourselves during communion and also during the agape feast. So we have agape feasts. We just call them potlucks, right? A time of getting together, breaking food. We don't break food. We eat it here. We eat food together. Isn't it funny how we get biblical terms that come through your mouth we never say in our lives? We come together and we eat well. But we need to do it with consideration of others. Again, we have had potlucks here, I guess, and some people say, I didn't know. I said, it doesn't matter. Just come. Just don't get in the end of the line. Just make sure you get in line. We usually have more than enough. And if you don't eat the desserts, they make me take them home. And we have you guys ever seen the peanut butter pies? I have to take it home, and I found out no one in my house likes it. My wife doesn't like it. My girls don't eat it. But it's a gift, so I couldn't throw it away. I was like, I need to get rid of this, so I figured out how to do it. You ever eat peanut butter pie? It's like heavy, right? It hits you like a rock. Wait 30 minutes, you need another. I ate the whole thing, and I was like, Terry, don't ever get me another pie. But when we have these things, we're able to come together and just sit and talk and just get to know each other more intimately, aren't we? But we need to make sure that we treat each other fairly and equally. Not just in food, in the way we, you know, elevate people. We don't need it. We're all equal in the Lord, part of the same family. Now again, you're going to be drawn to others that have commonalities. You see the worship guys, and they talk about the same stuff all the time. I like to throw words in there, and I don't even know what they're, music words, they're just talking. I'm like, oh, yeah, this or that. I have no idea what they're talking about. Security guys, don't really like, a little boring to me after a while. They're talking about security things. They're like, yeah, that's great. We see that coming together, but in general, we still should be talking to each other about different things. Now, relating to the agape feast, they coupled with communion. Paul directs everyone, eat at home. Even at the agape feast, even if we have a feast, there's some of you that just never ending, what is it called, that bottomless pit you got there? You need to eat some before you come so that you don't deprive others. You'd be the guy that throws three pieces of pie on there because I don't want to come back and it's gone. You know what I mean? It's gone because you just went through the line. That's what he's saying. It's that if you're that hungry, eat some before you go. I would say we probably need to balance how much we eat anyway. So what he's really saying, he says, here's the thing. The Lord's Supper was not a time of self-indulgence, but for mutual edification. You guys are missing the whole picture. So with that, can I have the worship team come up? And we'll conclude in this message. No one ought to come to the communion table who is not a true believer. Why? You're remembering what he did. If you don't know him, now you hear the communion, the message about communion, and the gospel is in there as well. Jesus came to die for your sins. And we do this to remember because we tend to forget in our daily life of what he's done for us. Not only what he's done for us, but the love that he has for us. Nor as a true believer should we come to the table if our heart is not right with God and with our fellow Christians. He said we need to make those things right. Again, we give you that time before communion to bring those to the Lord. That's why we have that preparation time. So think about it, a reflection time is a time of preparing yourself to enter into this special observation, this special supper, as we could call it, with our Lord and with each other. We don't want to enter it in the wrong way and have God discipline us. He's like, you can choose to discipline yourself, make the correction yourself, or allow God to do it himself for us, which we don't want to do that, right? If you had the choice, okay, do I want my dad to correct me? This is the way I always looked at it, because my mom would make us wait all day. Wait till your dad gets home. You guys ever hear that? That's torture in itself. That's cruel and unusual punishment, ladies. Wait till your dad. You're thinking, you know how your dad is, if you reflect, when he got home and he's already tired? Oh, that's, and he walks in the door and she's like, your son. It's now your kids, right? Your sons, because my mom had three boys. She probably told my dad every day. If the Lord urges you to rededicate yourself to the living God, to the gospel, he says, I want you to rededicate yourselves, reminding us how you live. Communion causes us to reflect on our daily life. Am I living in a way that pleases God? Am I maturing as a believer? What is my... So this all preparation is a lot in that short moments. How am I living? Am I growing? Am I still an infant Christian? Am I a young adult? Have I matured into adult? Have I matured into the point where God can really use me? Again, when I say it that way, he's the one that matures you. We just got to allow him to do it. It asks us to, if there's division among you and someone else, reconcile with them before you come to the communion table. Again, you know, you can go and reconcile and they don't want to, but you have to take that step. You've done your part, they have to do theirs. So it also requires that we confess and repent of unconfessed sin prior to partaking of communion. So with that said, let's stand. As we end with this last song of worship, we're going to have people up here to pray with you. If you need prayer for anything, please come up. We're here to come alongside you and pray with you and encourage you.
Yes, too sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy.
Jesus, Jesus, precious.
you so much for your word today. Father, thank you that we can come to you with everything, Lord. We already know what's in our hearts, God. You've searched us and you know us, Lord. You're familiar with all of our ways, and you still call us to come. Father, we say thank you for that. And we want to be open and forthright with you about everything. God, help us to know that we're in tender and loving hands, and that, God, it is for our good and for your glory, God, that we give you everything, Lord, including those areas of our lives, God, where we're so scared to, God, but you are good. God, help us to do that. Help us to be honest with you and honest with each other, God, and love one another the way you've loved us, God. Thank you, God. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. If you guys need prayer, please come to the front. You guys have a wonderful week.